Hello, so are you talking about the diffusion model of PN junction as diode with this nonlinear Ohm law like here diffusion in one direction is simple, but in the other is more difficult. So the big question is, can we consider the diffusion of electrons? So naively, there are some problems. For large particles, there is no problem, but for electrons, it's not so simple. So looking at this lattice as a semiconductor, we could ask what are the currents between its nodes? And so this asking about the currents is exactly asking about diffusion model. So, but the problem is that standard diffusion, I recall GLW, generic random walk, gives a nonsense, gives nearly uniform distribution, like here for the defect lattice. So it's crucial that we do it right. So the problem is that it only maximizes entropy locally, while we should do it globally. We need to really, really maximize entropy. So this is about maximal entropy random walk-based model. The big difference is localization. So here is a lattice with defects. Also, the squares are defects. And the question is, what is the density after 10 steps, 100, 1000? So we can see that in standard random walks and diffusion, there is nearly uniform distribution. That means if you put electric field, there will be flow. So here, semiconductor becomes conductor. But in maximal entropy random walk, you see that there is strong localization. It's called Anderson-like localization. So we get exactly the quantum ground state probability distribution. So let's look at some simulator. So here we have a lattice with defects. The red bars are defects that there is missing edge in this lattice. So if you use standard random walk, GLW, here is the stationary probability distribution. We can see that it is nearly uniform. There is only the density is proportional to degree of a vertex. So here we have degree 4 or 3 or 2. So it's nearly uniform. But if we go to maximal entropy random walk, the stationary probability distribution for this walker is completely different. It localizes in this Anderson-like localization. It depends on the defect density. This simulator is available from the league. You can play with it. Also, we can here attach the external voltage. So now we make that jumping right, we become more likely than jumping left. So the stronger voltage, the more localized the flow. We can also here play with the evolution of such dynamic. But if you start with, if you know that electrons were here at the beginning, what is the probability that they are in given position after some times? Okay, so I have made this simulator many years ago, and a few months ago, I decided to try to build a working PN junction, and it turned out successful. So far as, for example, I have put it here in this GitHub discussion, and you can see that only positive reviews. So it seems that the general description of PN junction is quite magical with some holes. And here is, we just look at diffusion of electrons in the semiconductors. Okay, let's go back to the slides. Okay, so the big question is, maybe let's go to next. So the big question is, should we use standard diffusion or this maximizing entropy diffusion? So there are two philosophies. So should we split them, look at given moment in time and consider some ensemble, for example, Boltzmann ensemble in this moment of time? Like here, like if you have infinite well 0 1, then natural assumption is that the stationary probability distribution should be uniform there. However, in quantum mechanics, you would say that the stationary probability distribution should be sine squared. It's more localized. So the question which one is better and when? So turns out that in many cases, and the latter is better, especially for electrons, and we discussed. So here is very nice. This is a tunneling microscope scope data that we have semiconductor and look at energy density in a given position. So we can see that it's strongly localized. So it's not like in standard random walk, but rather in this maximal entropy random walk, which also says the same as quantum ground state, like here. So are electrons the only object for using this quantum-like random walk, which is kind of dynamic for the random walk, that instead of using ensemble of points in fixed time, we need to use the ensemble of entire trajectories. So we assume uniform or Boltzmann distribution among entire trajectories. So this way, you're getting much better localization, like here, sine square localization. For example, for neutrons, so there are much larger particles, heavier, and it turns out there is this nice 2002 paper that the solid line is for this classical random walk. So we have a mirror, and there are jumping neutrons above this mirror with gravitational field, and put absorber in various positions. And the question is, what is the probability distribution of finding them, the neutron? So the solid line is this standard classical diffusion, like here uniform. The dotted line is the quantum ground state stationary probability distribution. This is exactly as we get from this maximal random walk, this corrected diffusion using ensemble of paths instead of points in given moment of time. So here we have ensemble of points like Boltzmann distribution of positions. So here we have ensemble of entire paths. So if you would use ensemble of paths from now toward future or from now toward past, you would get the first power. You would get just sine here. But if you use ensemble of full paths that we leave kind of between the past and future, then we need to multiply both amplitudes from the past and from the future, getting the sine square. This is a general intuition where the Born rule comes from, that Born rule needs to multiply the two amplitudes, and the two amplitudes goes from two directions. So I also talk about Isaac model. In Isaac model, these two directions are left and right. Here there are past and future, like in the scattering matrix I also mentioned. Okay, so there is this big question. So when can we use diffusion, where we cannot? So where is this boundary between classical and quantum physics? So I try to argue that maybe there is no boundary, but rather there are two different perspectives on the same system. For example, having this coupled oscillator, we could use kind of classical description, but you could also go to normal modes and getting kind of quantum unitary evolution, like here. Then going to lattice of oscillator, we could get this classical description, but you could go just to Fourier modes, normal modes, and they are treated as particles in quantum field theories. The big difficulty is going further to infinite lattice limit, like hydrodynamics. So there is, from one side, there are nice experiments, these walking droplets I mentioned briefly, that they get many quantum objects. There is quantum mechanics. So there are many similarities, and one of them is this maximal to random walk. From the other, there are also this varying number of particles used usually with this perturbative QFT, that we have these diagrams representing some scenarios. But you could try to ask, what is the field represented by this scenario? So for example, electron has this Coulomb-like electric field around. So we could try to go to this classical kind of perspective, but also we could go from classical to this kind of ensemble. So not knowing all the details of the scattering, we should assume, for example, this Feynman ensemble among possible scenarios, getting perturbative QFT also used for solitons. Okay, so for example, we have this kind of quantum classical objects in superconductors, these fluxons, these quants of magnetic field, Abrikosov vortex. They have topological nature. They observe interference for the tunneling, Aharonov-Bohm effect, but there is a short-range interaction. So there are these hydrodynamical great experiments. So for example, they have this vibrating containment of liquid, and there is a droplet getting this classical object with coupled wave around, and then this coupled wave work as this pilot wave. So they get a double interference in double slit. So here are the single trajectories, and averaging over many single trajectories, these droplets they get interference pattern. They get this orbit quantization that this coupled wave has to become a standing wave. What limits to some integer radii here? This standing wave is kind of described by Schrödinger and stationary Schrödinger equation. And also they get double quantization. So both there is angular momentum in the horizontal axis and the radius in vertical axis. And we can see that double quantization, like of two quantum numbers, is observed there. So there are only short range interaction, but we can also get a long range interaction. For example, in liquid crystal, they get this Hedgehog-like topological charge. And in long-range interaction, for example, Coulomb-like interaction between this hedgehog. So looking at the position of such two hedgehogs, it agrees with Coulomb-Coulomb, for example, interaction. So we can get particle-like objects. And this is generally the direction I'm working on. So you can click on these slides and getting more details. Okay, so returning to repaired diffusion. So having some graph, for example, here. The question is how to choose a random walk for this graph. So a natural choice is that being here, there is this drunken sailor and he toss a coin, roll a dice, and choose with this probability distribution, this assumed probability distributions, maximizing entropy for each vertex. That means using uniform probability distribution for each outgoing edge. So in MERV we have a different philosophy that we don't think about single edges, but want to maximize entropy, as here this entropy production is called also entropy rate. That we have standard Shannon entropy here, but also we need to average it over the stationary probability distribution of vertices. So this is the final entropy we'd like to maximize. So. A standard random walk maximizes locally. For each step, it maximizes entropy, but maximum entropy random walk maximizes mean entropy production. That what is the average entropy produced during this random walk? So it is weighted by the stationary probability distribution. Here are these two examples of evolution. So we have a lattice, we have defects. So here the defects are self loops, and the self loop is removed in the defect. So if it's not a defect, then we have degree 5, and in defect we have degree 4. So putting this electron here, walker here, after 100 steps we have this distribution. After 1,000, it stabilizes in this nearly uniform distribution. But in MERV, the locally it looks similar, but after 100 steps we see that it's very different, and finally it localizes, stabilizes in completely different localized distribution. Which is putting some external voltage here, electric field. Here do we get the flow? We have a conductor. Here we don't have a conductor because it's prevented. The electrons are prisoned in this region. So here are this experimental data from this tunneling microscope. So we can see that it's much more resembling this quantum-like, so this is exactly as quantum ground state distribution in MERV. I will also mention that we get the Schrödinger equation here, but only the ground state. So it is usually said that for this localization there is needed interference. MERV shows that we don't need interference. It's just replacing this local entropy maximization with global entropy maximization, and we get this localization. There is no interference in this model. So these are kind of two philosophies. So in GRW, standard random walk, you assume that indeed our walker uses this probability distribution. So toss a coin, roll a dice, and according to these probabilities. But in MERV, it's a different philosophy. So we use the entropy maximization when there is something happening, but we don't know what exactly, and you would like then the most probable scenario. So if we know that electron was here at the beginning, after 10 steps, this is the probability distribution, which is the safest assumption for us. This is after 100. So in MERV, we shouldn't assume that the walker directly uses the model, but we only use the model to get the best prediction of the Walker's evolution. Okay, so why should we maximize entropy? So for example, having a length n sequence of zeros and ones with p percentage of ones, how many bits we need to choose one? So this is the number of length n sequences with p probability of one. So asymptotically, if you use ceiling formula, we get this approximation with two to power n length times Shannon entropy. For this Shannon entropy. So maximization of entropy means that if we don't know what p should we choose, the safest choice, knowing nothing about the details, the safest choice is p equals 1/2, because if for p equal 1/2, the entropy the highest. So this subset for given p dominates the entire set of possibilities. So entropy maximization is kind of focusing on subset of which grows the fastest with parameters that make subset growing the fastest. So we get this Jane's principle of maximal entropy, that if there are some parameters we don't know, some statistical parameters like probability here, then the safest assumption for them is the one maximizing entropy, because such assumption restricts our family to subfamily which grows the fastest. So not knowing that everything, we should, the safest choice is the model which maximizes entropy. Okay, so here is a simple example why we should use MERV, not GRW. So why it's crucial to use this entropy maximization. So this example is called Fibonacci coding, that we have a sequence of zeros and ones, but there are forbidden two ones. So after one, there has to be zero. So we have this kind of matrix, this kind of graph. So after one, we have to go to zero, but after zero, we have some freedom of going to zero or one. So in probabilistic model, we have one parameter Q for this adjacency matrix. So the question is how to really choose this Q. So naively we should choose 1/2 because it maximizes entropy. However, it also increases the probability of being in zero. So in being in one, but in one we don't produce any entropy. So we would like to use Q a bit above 1/2 to make zero more probable, because only in zero we produce entropy. So we need to find the stochastic matrix. For this stochastic matrix, we can find this stationary probability distribution. So what is the probability of being in each vertex? And then we can find this mean entropy. So not only Shannon entropy, but also averaged over the stationary probability distribution of being in this vertex or this vertex. So now this is the plot based on this Q. So we can see that 1/2 is not the maximum. The maximum is a bit shifted toward right. With this is the exact formula, this golden ratio. So instead of 1/2, you should use 0.618 probability of going to right as the best choice. So the question is how to find it. So we could write this formula and try to maximize it, but it's not very convenient. So another way is looking at how can we maximize the information content in this each encoding in such sequences. So we can assume you have the highest entropy if having uniform probability distribution, but now not in one steps, but in the space of entire sequences. So we have space of paths on this kind of graph, and in this space of paths, we would like to use uniform probability distribution in the space of paths. So instead of thinking about single steps, we have to use ensemble of the infinite paths. Yes. Okay, so let's derive the formula. So here there are assumed more general Boltzmann distribution. So wanting to have uniform distribution, and use potentials zero if there is allowed jump in this M matrix, and infinite if there is forbidden. So using this kind of potential, we can get them the distribution as in the previous. But generally, now we assign an energy to each path and use the Boltzmann distribution among these paths. So this is Ising model. So for this potential, which defines our energy, we find this transfer matrix, this exponent of minus beta times energy associated with given transition from jumping from I to J cost this amount of energy. And now you like to use Boltzmann ensemble of paths from minus infinity to plus infinity and asking what is the probability of I in the center of such infinite paths. Yes, so like here, the rho is the number of probability of paths with I here divided by the probability of any value here. Yes. So we need to find this look at this ensemble of paths, Boltzmann ensemble. So how to work with Boltzmann ensemble? So we can take power of this matrix M. So having a power of matrix M, asking at ij coordinates. So from combinatorial perspective, it is sum over all paths of length L, starting in I and ending in J. And there is this energy of as sum of these steps. So we get Boltzmann ensemble in this power of M. On the other side, usually this M matrix, so this is called Frobenius Perron theorem for connected acyclic graph. So in practice, usually we can assume this that there is this dominant eigenvalue. So a large power for L to infinity limit, we can assume that there is only one eigenvector. So it's only the dominant eigenvector corresponding to the highest lambda, absolute value of lambda. So from quantum mechanics perspective, this M will be correspond to minus Hamiltonian. So this maximization of lambda, in fact, corresponds to minimization of energy. So going to this quantum ground state. So to M to power L can be approximated as this one using this single eigenvector. So now we can find this probability distribution of having I in the center of such paths. Yes. So we have L step towards left. So we have this M to power L and 2 power 2 indexes ji. So this is I we are asking for, and j turns out not important in this limit to infinity. And the same toward right. So now there is ik, and in this infinity we have only psi I square. So we have this Born rule, known in physics, but now the psi's are not complex as in quantum mechanics, but only real non-negative, usually positive. So now this kind of probability like amplitudes. But we have the Born rule, and the Born rule comes from having two directions. So in Ising model, we have kind of propagator from the left and propagator from the right. So we can also assume this in time. Also, we get this psi squared because you have propagator from the past and propagator from the future, for example, in the scattering matrix. So we have this intuition where the square in the Born rule comes from. And now we can also, you find that the stochastic propagator like here. And for example, you have the probability of path. So probability of path going from vertex gamma zero, gamma one, and so on is the psi. And then there are these divisions. So it doesn't depend on, oh, it depends on energy, yes. Okay, so coming it for Ising model, I have this paper for two dimensional Ising model. So for example, let's, for two dimensional Ising model, we have this 2D lattice, let's say, of spin up, spin down. So there is this called this Hammersley-Clifford theorem, which says that we have this nice conditional distribution. So having all the values around all these blue values and wanting to find the probability distribution with question mark, in fact, we need to know the four green dots. So here kind of local formula of Markov property in multidimensional for Markov fields. So it's like this Markov property standard, but generalized to high dimensions. So here is kind of global. So wanting to have these question marks, probability distribution, conditional based on the all blue values. It's sufficient to know the green values. Or we can also use it in scanning way, that having all the values here, and we would like this question mark. In fact, we need only to know this front, kind of the last line to get the probability distribution of the question mark. And now we can scan over the lines, line by line, and getting them all the spins, for example, to generate some spin configuration accordingly to the model, or to write data in this kind of medium. So how to find these question marks, the probability distribution. So based on the green values, what is the probability distribution for the question mark? So we can use, let's say some finite width approximation. So we have W width approximation, and we look at two such stripes. So they have height one value and width W value. And we look at two such stripes, and then we have one dimensional case for such stripes. So now it represents width W approximation, but using this MERV, the previously derived formulas, you can find that what is the probability distribution of such pairs of stripes, neighboring stripes. So using this formula, so it is literally finding this dominant eigenvector, and this is the probability distribution of pair of stripes UV. So now we can find the probability distribution inside this shape. So we do it by marginalization, by summing over this star position, and now we can find this conditional distribution. That knowing these four values, what is the probability distribution of question mark? And these methods work very well. So this is the error for this exact solution for a two-dimensional Ising. So there are very, very, very nice. It works very close to the real values. Okay, so here are the final formulas. One more time, so maybe let's look at them. So in standard random walk, the characteristic length, so having this drunken sailor, he looks one step toward future and assumes uniform probability distribution among possible steps toward future can do. So we have M is this Argentine matrix, and D is the degree of given vertex, and he uses uniform probability distribution. While in MERV, we need to find these dominant eigenvectors, generally left right. So if matrix is symmetric, they are the same, but if it's not symmetric, then we need to find the left and right eigenvectors dominant to the maximal absolute value of lambda. And the stationary probability distribution in standard random walk is proportional to degree. And in MERV, we have this Born rule. Here is the stochastic propagator. It can be kind of toward future, but you can also find toward past. So it is kind of time symmetric because we use ensemble of paths. So it doesn't matter if you try to go toward left or right in Ising model or for past future in this in random walk in time. Okay, so let's look at a simpler situation. This is one dimensional lattice. So lattice looks like here, that we have these vertices, we can jump left or right. Finally, there is a cycling boundary conditions. Additionally, there are these self loops that from given position can be jump toward itself. However, some self loops are removed. So in defects, there is no self loop. So defects have degree 2, normal vertex has degree 3. Yes? So here is a length 1000, such lattice, one dimensional lattice with cycling boundary conditions. With 1, 2, 3 defects, yes. And so for a standard random walk, we have probability distribution is proportional to degree. Yes. So here you'd get the probability distribution 3, 3, 3, or 2. So they are very quite close. The stationary probability distribution in such a random walk. But for MERV, we get this extremely strong localization. So probability of being here is like a million times larger than being here. So we had very strong localization, so one dimensional already. So it's a completely different. Using standard atom walk here and using MERV, it's completely different behavior. You can see, yes. Okay, so we could also perform this infinite continuous limit to infinitesimal limit, getting we get the stationary Schrödinger equation. So as I said, it's kind of quantum mechanics, but only going to with no interference and only going to the ground state. So what about the excited state? So there are there, but they vanish exponentially. So we can see here that starting in this position, after 10 steps, you are here. After 100 steps, you are here. So we can see that this is similar to first excited state. So here is the ground state, first excited, second excited, third excited. So we, locally, we got here because we have started close to this excited state and far from this ground state. So we kind of first locally, we have kind of sub-diffusion to this local low energy state, and then kind of super diffusion to this ground state. So there are excited states, however, they are not stable unless there is some addition, maybe there is some additional mechanism, they could be stable. So for example, in atoms, we know that excited state is not stable, it won't to the excite to the ground state. However, if there is no place in the ground state because there are already electrons there, then the excited state have to be stable because it's the lowest energy state already, yes. Okay, so let's go to the central problem or to this to the semiconductor p-n junction model. So here we have a few things. So we have this lattice, but there is also vertex potential, but we have the defects. We have two types of these defects, p-n Yes, so in semiconductor we have these additional atoms, which have additional electrons in n, or missing electrons in p. So here there are modeled as potential increased by 1/2, let's say, or negative potential. So we increase or decrease potential. So here is the red one are repulsive. So we can see that the density is here and here, and because they're repulsed, and the green are attractive. So we can see that the nearly all the density went to them. However, this model is very simple because it is, but in practice we have thousands or billions of electrons. So the problem is how to include further electrons. So as in quantum mechanics, we could go to tensor product, but the dimension grows exponentially, so it's completely not practical. So the approach I have developed here is this mean field approach, that we say that the other electrons have the same probability distribution as this electron we are thinking about, but only contribute in the potential. So here we have this potential as below, which contains this vertex potential, but also this external voltage, which prefers jumping left or right, but also this contribution from the density we will find here. So assuming that other electrons have also this density, with this Poisson equation. So how this charge density creates potential? So using this inverted Laplacian operator, we can get the potential getting from this density. So we get, it's more complicated now. It's not just finding the dominant eigenvector, but in this matrix using this dominant eigenvector, there is also contribution from the potential created by the solution, by the density. So there is a difficult to solve this more general MERV-like situation. So here is example of adding this gamma. This gamma means what is the contribution of these other electrons. So basically the Coulomb repulsion. So while here is this strong localization, this additional interaction between electrons make them repel, so want to equalize the distribution again. So we can see that here they are very localized, but when we increase this gamma, this interaction between electrons, we go to more and more equalized distribution. It is for repulsive, here is for attractive. So we can see that this repulsion of electrons can make the distribution more very important to get the, so without this contribution, you get linear OML also. We will not get the p-n junction. So this was crucial in the paper. So we have this equalizing Coulomb that it wants to make the distribution more uniform. Okay, so another difficult idea, non-trivial idea, is that we need to use two types of boundary conditions. So here, top right, we can use standard cyclic boundary conditions. So this is the Laplacian used in this Poisson equation to get from density to get the potential. So in this vertical direction, we can use standard cyclic boundary conditions. However, in the horizontal, it's more difficult here because if you use cyclic, then the potential on here and here will be the same. But in the p-n junction, this potential is not the same. There is so-called built-in voltage. So to get this built-in voltage, that is crucial to use a bit different. So I have used this reflective boundary condition. So it's kind of imagining that having the charge here, there is a reflected charge behind the wall. Yes. Yeah? So here is this Laplacian to inverted Laplacian. So what is the potential created by density in various positions? So if the charge is here, then we have contribution here, but also this cyclic boundary condition also here. Yes. However, if it is here, then we don't have this cyclic boundary condition like here, but we have larger contribution locally here. So we can see that it's a bit darker than here. Yes. So it is crucial to use these good boundary conditions and this reflective work well. Okay, so here are the final results. So we would like to get this diode. So standard description is that there are some holes. So here there are no holes. There are just electrons, but they localize in this attractive region because of this Anderson-like localization. So in standard diffusion, there will be no localization. There will be nearly uniform. But thanks to using this proper maximizing entropy random walk, agreeing with quantum mechanics, you get this localization like here. So having this external voltage now, here is forward and backward direction, reverse bias. So here is reverse bias. We don't have the flow. And here is the forward bias, we see that the flow. So we can see that here it's simpler to get the flow, see here it's difficult. So here is this flow current depending on this external voltage. It's non-linear, but after crossing this breakdown voltage, we get the conductance in this reverse bias. So here is the charge distribution. So the brown one here is without external voltage. So we can see that everything is localized. And then for positive, quickly equalizes this charge distribution. For negative, reverse bias is much more difficult to equalize. So here is the potential, his entire potential, his potential, we've subtracted this external potential. So for negative bias, all this additional potential is nearly as this built-in voltage. But for positive, we can see that it quickly grows and it becomes nearly equalized very soon. So we can see this asymmetry here very well. Generally, we have and dopants have additional electrons, and they want to go to this p region. So naively they should smear over the p region, but it would lead to this Coulomb repulsion increase. This is why it's crucial to use this self-interaction, this Coulomb repulsion, which prevents smearing over the entire green field. So we found this interaction. You would get nearly all electrons would get here. So we would have no neutral regions. To get neutral regions, we need to use this Coulomb equalization with this mean field contribution. So treating the density also as the density of the remaining electrons, which creates the potential. Okay, so here are some plots for various. So here is reverse bias, here is forward bias. So we can see in forward bias, the flow starts very soon. And the reverse bias is more difficult. And you can see there is some domain wall which shifts. And then when this domain wall reaches the localized, reaches the boundary, then the flow starts, the conductance starts very soon, very quickly. So there are no holes. There are just electron densities. With diffusion done right, as in quantum mechanics, but this is just diffusion. There is no interference here. Okay, so there is this difficult question: how to numerically get this self interaction. So the trick is that we can use this parametrization as exponent of some value. Doing so, we enforce that we find search for eigenvector with only non-negative positive coordinates, and this is the ground state. Only the ground state has all positive coordinates. So using this parametrization, we can try to define the constraints as the left-right eigenvectors and the normalization, and then try to satisfy all the constraints with some gradient methods like some Newton Raphson. So it's more than the difficult part. If there is some idea to do it better, it would be great. But it is the most numerically challenging part to get it right. Okay, to finish, there are kind of three philosophies of random walk, of complex behavior. So one is stochastic process, that assuming that the walker toss a coin in every step and do some random choices. From the other, there is this chaos ergodic picture that there is some complex but deterministic trajectory, and it averages to something reasonable. And here is kind of thermodynamical picture that we have some position, and the question is what probability distribution to choose. So we should use ensemble of paths, possible paths going to this point, and in this ensemble of paths, ask what is this local stochastic propagator. So this is kind of different philosophy. This is kind of thermodynamic statistical physics philosophy. And only this one agrees with quantum mechanics that we so this is the standard diffusion. And this is too simplified because we don't know the exact dynamics. And this is kind of the safest assumption that we don't know everything, but use this entropy maximization, which is the safest assumption. So it works. So for electrons, for neutrons, indeed, experimentally, you should do this approach, which works much better than the stochastic, because the stochastic doesn't work completely. Okay, to finalize, so we have two philosophies here. So we could use standard diffusion for this 0-1 range, getting uniform distribution. So standard diffusion has this fixed time and use, let's say, Boltzmann distribution here. Or we could use Boltzmann distribution, but this time among trajectories. So it is similar to quantum mechanics, it's called Euclidean quantum mechanics, but now it does say that this is properly done diffusion according to the maximum entropy principle, and getting this localized solution, which is kind of safest, and it agrees with electrons. I have tried to convince, and also for neutron, that also it's not the classical diffusion, but this ground state stationary probability distribution experimentally. So finally, having this Bohm rule as this one that unidirectional trajectories, we get only the first power of amplitude. To get the squares, we need to use ensemble of complete trajectories toward past and future. One amplitude goes from the past, second from the future. So now we get this Bohm rule. So this Bohm rule is very non-trivial. So intuitive probabilistic, we have so-called Kolmogorov third axiom, that probability of alternative is sum of probabilities. That if you don't know this question mark, you should sum over two possibilities for this tossing three coins here. However, in quantum mechanics, we have this Born rule. So we can replace this Kolmogorov third axiom with this probability as sum of amplitudes square. So this is completely different. So we can see that if deriving some inequality with the first, the second might be able to violate it. And this is this Bell examples. So here is examples. So this is called Mermis inequality. It's much more simpler, much more kind of brutal than Bell. So in Bell, you can make some hand waving, but this is here is much more difficult to do such hand waving. So this is kind of tossing three coins, at least to give the same. It's completely obvious Dirichlet principle or something. So we can prove it using this Kolmogorov third axiom, very simple, that using any probability distribution on eight possibilities, at least it has to sum of at least one. However, if you use this Born rule instead, then using this amplitude, we get violation to 6/10. So we get 2/10 here, 6/10 here. So we can get the violation of this inequality. So there is a problem, yes. So the question is where this Born rule comes from, and I've mentioned that it's from symmetry, like here that one psi goes from the past, second from the future. So then this is the final slide. So there is this big question: how to think about time? Yes. So we naively assume presentism that we have current moment in time and it evolves in time. So it is kind of in classical mechanics, it's Euler-Lagrange equation, for example, this evolution equation. However, there is this second philosophy, second philosophy of time is this Einstein block universe called Eternalis. Now we assume that we have kind of symmetric boundary conditions in the past and future. And now instead of Euler-Lagrange, we use the least action principle. That among the possible trajectories up to histories of the universe, there was chosen one history which optimizes the action. And now we are traveling to this already found solution. So we could translate between solution found with Euler-Lagrange to this one. However, solutions found in one of them originally have a bit different properties, like this Born rule. It's only in this time symmetric philosophy, but here we get this Bell theorem, which says that there is a problem. We cannot have nice field theories. There is a problem. But if we solve in this way, if this kind of superdeterministic solution, having some measurement in future, it was already prepared to be right. So there is this scattering matrix, which also uses these two amplitudes. So there's the big question where the two amplitudes come from. And also there one comes from the past as the propagator from, let's say, minus infinity to now, and second from the plus infinity to now. So there are many suggestions that the Born rule comes from this time symmetric. And having Born rule, as a replacement for this Kolmogorov axiom, you can get the Bell violation. So that's my generally answer that we can use classical mechanics, but saying that it was originally solved with the least action principle. So we can translate it to this Euler-Lagrange, but it has a bit different properties. So analogously, so we could use some diffusion. So if using Boltzmann path ensemble, we get this Merv diffusion. If you get the Feynman path ensemble, then we get Schrödinger equation. But also Schrödinger equation is also a theory. So it should satisfy the Bell theorem. So to get away from Bell, it uses the measurement. So it's going out of the theory. So it does not longer know what's happening. So, but using Feynman path ensemble, we get these two amplitudes are coming from the past and future. So this is a safer way. So finally, you have these two philosophies. One is static 3D. and it's wrong. Often it predicts uniform distribution, why it should be, let's say, sine square, and it's done right if using this ensemble of paths instead. However, there is missing interference in this model, and usually interference is believed to be required for this Anderson localization. Here I have shown that it is not required, that it's something different. So the question is, what changes interference? For example, if you have this benzene aromatic ring, there could be interference. So that's a big question to understand contribution of interference to conductance. Okay, thank you for attention.